Okay, welcome everyone. We're going to get started. For those of you that are just joining us, if you could just let me know you can hear us in the chat area of your GoToWebinar panel. We are going to get started. So, we're excited to be able to introduce to you Mary Williamson. And she's from Wild Bill's Furs, and she's known as the fur doctor to the stars out here in Hollywood. So it's a pleasure to introduce her, and she's got several years of experience dealing with the celebrities, and we've got some great photos to share with you about some of the work she's done. So welcome, Mary.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yes. How about to start out, if you could tell us, who is Wild Bill? Because you sure don't look like Wild Bill.
No, I'm not. I think Barb has a picture up right here of the of Wild Bill and a little information on him. He was a real fun character, and he was very innovative. And in fact, the store that I started working with him originally at, it had big, bright gray and black zebra stripes, really huge, painted in front on the front of the store, and it had great big, huge yellow lettering at the top. It was something that was really distinctive and stood out, and that's kind of how Bill was, and he was always trying to come up with fun things. He was a fun guy, and so he was actually, you know, the original founder, and I think you could probably read a little bit about his background on the type that's on the side of the picture. And so, yeah, he was quite a guy.
Okay, awesome. And then you mentioned that he started up his business in 1968. He sold fur, rugs, and mounts from a mobile storefront on the infamous Sunset Strip. And about 5 years into his business, the Endangered Species Act of 1973 was set up, and that limited the purchase of lions and tigers, leopards, and other African species, which then increased the value of the trophies that people had acquired. So now, while Bill realized there just wasn't anyone else with his expertise to do this kind of restoration work, and so they found that the trophies had a life expectancy of about 50 years. So while Bill developed these techniques and used his experience and knowledge as a hunter and was able to become a resource who could preserve these heirloom trophies for years to come. So I think it's fantastic. And one thing that I've learned from Mary is that her joy comes from restoring these antique trophies. Maybe they were passed on from family members. And so she's seen a lot of different types of trophies and fur rugs. And she has a vast knowledge of these items. And so let's find out more about Mary herself. Could you tell us your background and how you got started with Wild Bill's and restoring furs?
Well, it actually probably, you know, I look back on my life, and you know, I'm thinking there's this expression I've heard so many times. It's do what you love, and the money will follow. Well, if I look back on my life, I was always having hobbies that involved working with my hands and creating things. And my grandmother lived in San Diego. We went to the zoo about once a year for years and years and years. And I had animals myself, and I was always fascinated on how their fur worked. You know, on the nose, the short hair of the nose would go one direction at the tip of the nose, and then it would change directions. The ears would have a different fur, and there'd be longer fur on different parts of the body and so forth and so on. And if any of you have animals, you know, you may want to just kind of take a moment and look at the wonder of how all this different fur and all the directions of the fur on your animal. Anyhow, you know, on and on, my dad had a welding business, and I could always earn extra money with Dad by going there and operating his equipment and doing things with tools and so forth and so on. I was an art major in college, and I did interior design work, and I had a passion for restoring old antiques. And and I also loved to ski. One day at the top of the hill in Mammoth Mountain, I met Wild Bill. And from that point on, I loved what he did. Eventually started taking some things home that he had extra. He had a huge amount of zebras that came in. He taught me how to restore those. I loved it. Eventually started working for him. As time went on, he wanted to retire, and I started managing the store for him. He became a little bit ill, and I managed the store for him, and he decided to retire, and at that point I took it over. And here I am.
Yeah. Oh, I think that's wonderful. And of course, I have a soft spot in my heart for women entrepreneurs. You can see here on the screen that you can see Mary's website at wildbillsfurs.com. And she has a beautiful website that explains what they do and more information about Wild Bill and the services that they offer. One of her most recent projects was she was commissioned to repair the large grizzly that is used on the Last Man Standing show. So you can see Tim Allen here standing in front of the grizzly, and it's the same grizzly that we had on our welcome screen. And so Mary has done extensive restoration on it, and it's now found a happy home with Tim Allen. Mary, tell us about the next photo here about the coyote rug.
Well, this particular one was one that Wild Bill's made for a living room of a family's home in Beverly Hills, I believe it was. And it's coyote, and as you can see, there's all kinds of coyote tails on it. And, this might be something that you may come across in your travels, in the disaster restoration world. And this particular one, they were always bringing it back in to us to repair because the tails kept falling off. You know, people would trip on the tails and so forth and so on. So, we kind of went through that era where people were really into coyote for some reason. I don't know if that was what the trend. I think it was just the trend at the time.
Sure. Yeah. And then next one.
The next one is an old zebra, and usually something like this would be something that most people would say just throw it away, but it belonged to a gal who had inherited from her grandfather, and it was something that he had actually gone on a safari, and he'd actually, taken it there on the safari and brought it home. It was in his home for many, many, many years, and then his granddaughter inherited it, and she didn't know what to do with it, so she just stuck it away in a box, and one day they just kind of got the idea, or they heard about us, actually, and brought it in, and, it was a little bit pricey to restore it because it was, very, very hard to do and very, very time-consuming, but yet we saw the the look on her face. I saw the look on her face and how bad she wanted it. So that was kind of my driving force in the whole time of putting this thing back together. It was like, oh, I just want it to look so great for her. And so that's what happened. And, something like this, it has an antique patina to it that, it just can't be captured any other way except for being antique. But it's one of these things that, there's lots of little pieces floating around, and if this was something that you were to scoop up after a disaster, you'd want to be sure and make sure that all the pieces were, as many as you could get, were available, and you scooped them up and took them with the particular zebra or whatever animal it is.
And Mary, I see here there are a lot of missing pieces, and how do you restore something like this?
Well, in this particular one, we have some old zebras that we were able to use the parts for. On other animals that are really endangered, we can use other furs like rabbit fur, fox fur, and dye them and treat them so that they blend in and they look pretty good as far as, you know, matching, like, say, a tiger or leopard or whatever. But we did have some spare parts, but as you can see, we had to match the stripes so that they were believably going in the same direction, and a little painting here and there, you know, kind of did the finishing touch on it.
So that's where your art background comes in handy then.
Absolutely, yeah. You have to kind of look at it from with an artist's eye, and it's like, how will this look when it's finished? How will it appear to the eye? So, yeah.
Okay, and next we have, you can tell us about this one.
Okay, this was a leopard that was, as you can see, it's in very bad shape. And I think it had lost one eye in somewhere along the line, and the jaw was cracking and falling apart. It was really, really old, and it was done with a clay base. That's why you see the brown in there, and the base was clay. Modern day, they use plastics and different products, so I kind of can judge how old an animal is by how it was originally constructed. So, you know, we had to sculpture, again, the art background, you know, I took in college, sculpturing, and had to re-sculpture and the inside of the mouth, and buy a new tongue for it. They have modern-day tongues that you can purchase, and we went ahead and put new eyes in. There's beautiful new eyes that are being made in Germany and in Italy that are a lot better than the old ones anyway. If you can see, if your screen's large enough, you can see the difference in a big yellow eye at the top of the picture.
Yeah.
That was the original eye. And then the more realistic ones that we put in on the picture below, added whiskers, you know, and also work on the body of the animal. But the face, I thought, was just quite a good example of how we had, we also had to resculpture the nose, too, as you could see. So, yeah.
Mary, what are some of the typical parts that are not natural? I mean, are the teeth natural? Do we save the jaws, the animal jaw, and the teeth?
Well, you know, another clue to how old it is very often, or how good the taxidermy was, how fine the taxidermy was, is if it has its original teeth or not. If it has its original teeth, sometimes that's a clue that it might be a little bit older animal, because they would often keep the skull inside, they would keep the skull inside that held the teeth. And some of the new, more modern-day mounts, they just have a plastic mouth set that the taxidermist can just stick in there, you know, fast and easy.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
Okay, great.
Does that answer my question on that one?
I believe so, yeah. And then one question, you've made mention of taxidermists.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's the difference from the service that you offer versus a taxidermist?
Well, we're more than anything a restoration specialist. And I suppose, you know, people, it's like calling a lot of different things jello. Now, I suppose just for the general public, you know, without getting real technical about it, we could be a restoration taxidermist. And we don't care, we don't do any of that bloody awful original work that they do when they put the original animal together. We just only restore them ourselves. So.
Okay, great. Thank you for clarifying that, because that helps me as well. Okay, and here's our poor bear.
Oh, this poor guy. Oh, my gosh. Just look at him, you know. You know, a lot of the pieces are there. And, I mean, again, thank heavens, my dad loved to do puzzles when I was a little girl. And I grew up, again, with the love of a puzzle. And this guy was definitely a puzzle, and you know, and you piece these back together, and try and looking at the direction of the fur. Where did this piece come from? Where did that piece come from? The thickness of the fur is a little thicker around the neck area and a little thinner at the belly area. So those are clues on how to put them back together. And you work on the back side and on the leather side. We kind of often refer to it as the leather side. That would, there's the fur side and then there's the leather side. And yeah, he was quite a job, but again, another sentimental piece that was, you know, definitely worth it to the people to have us spend as much time on it to put it back together.
And the structure of a piece like this is actually the felt backing, correct?
The structure
that keeps it all together? It's melted on the...
Well, not really. The skin of an animal is what keeps it together. However, when we restore them, we have a special method that we use, a special product that we call Skin Bond. And we also use nylon mesh product, too. It's kind of like fiberglassing a car, but only we're kind of doing that same process to a piece of fur on the leather side of it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of when we get finished with it, something like this. It's been skin bonded, and it's all together solid, and we can't clean it or anything until we've got it completely back together solid. And then what the lining does, it gives it a little bit more support in the long run, and then it kind of protects the underbody of it or the leather side of it, and it gives usually a little decorative border to the piece when you're finished.
Okay, great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And then is this a different zebra?
Yeah, this is a different one. This one was kind of interesting because a couple got married and they combined their households. And this was one that the new husband had as a bachelor, you know, and I think it was something, it's what they call a zebra skin. It hasn't been made into a rug yet.
Mm-hmm.
It's a skin, and he probably just had it draped over something real funky.
Somewhere in his man cave, right?
Yeah, his man cave, or, you know, his bachelor pad. He just had it it was funky, and perhaps in the way that he draped it over something, or just maybe, who knows what, had it on the floor. And so the new wife came along and saw the potential in it, and she said, oh, let's make this into a fine rug, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of always been in some decorating circles, you know, you could have a fine household if you had a zebra rug in your entry. And that's what I did, yeah.
Okay.
This particular one is a living room. It's got a funny line down the middle because it was actually published in a magazine, and House Beautiful, I believe it was. And this was a picture of Vidal Sassoon's living room, and we also make large rugs. That's one of our specialties. We're not into that, talking about that today in particular, but again, this may be something that you may run across in your travels. This particular slide is one that was made up through her designer. We usually work with people's people. And her designer came to us with the project for Christina Aguilera. And this was to go in an extremely large room. It's what they call a blue fox. And we had it done with the red leather border on it. And it was way, way, way too large for our facility. So we have a sail maker that we can work with sometimes. And then they let us rent their floor space for a bit. So this particular one, and it wasn't published, so I can't mention the name. But let's just say it was a red fox bedspread for a very well-known attorney here in the Los Angeles area. So, but again, something that you may come across.
Okay, well, thank you. Those are very interesting pieces, just seeing the scope of the work that you do. You can fix things and you can create brand new items, mm-hmm. too, from existing furs.
Right, and as I mentioned, I think these things might be possibly things that you may, you know, encounter in your work and come across.
Yeah, so I was excited to show the vast array of the things that Mary has worked with. Now, bringing it into our world, these are things that you may or may not encounter on disaster restoration jobs, flooding, fire losses, maybe working with a gallery or museum. And so, one of the major concerns for us is that we need to determine, first of all, the appropriate scope of the restoration work that's to be done. And we have to consider the limitations of the policy and determine, what level of restoration is expected. And so it may be that if there's limited coverage, all we may be able to do is lightly vacuum or air wash an item to get the debris off of it. But if it's going to go through full restoration, then we need to be very careful about selecting the appropriate expert. And so, like Mary said, there's a difference between taxidermists and restoration specialists. The owner of the fur or the rug or the trophy may already have an expert that they've dealt with and may want to continue using that expert to provide restoration services. Or you may be called in to, recommend your own specialty service provider. And we're introducing Mary as a resource for you because items can be shipped to her location here in Northridge, California. And she's, worked with a variety of items. In that process, she will help you by phone. You can send her photos and things, and she will instruct you on how to handle the piece, how to pack it, how to transport it. And what I'm showing you here is a pack-out pitfall waiting to happen. And Mary's going to explain to us a little bit later on about what's wrong with this photograph. But we want to avoid doing that. Another thing that we have to consider is that we may come across some very, what we might think is awful, representations of taxidermy items. And this is in the news recently where a man basically stuffed his cat and has it flying. So, as disaster restoration specialists, we go into homes. We don't know who we're working for. We don't know what we're going to encounter in a home. We may find things that are offensive, and so we still have to be professional in our dealings with them. And we also want to show respect for the specimen itself. And again, here we're showing the rug, the bear rug. And we may assume that this is a total loss. And yet, we need to really call an expert. And we have our mobile phones at the job site. We can call Mary or another expert, send them photographs, give them information to help you determine if this is an item that can be restored. This is part of the grizzly from Last Man Standing. And I'm going to let Mary tell you about the condition that it was brought to her in.
Oh, my goodness. this old grizzly bear had been, my guess is he was really old. And he basically came from a prop house and had been rented out and just sort of used and abused and patched up over the years. He had lion mane fur under his arms. He had deer fur on his claws. He had a smashed up foot. You can see it there on the left. And some of these old mounts, in order to have put the bear fur on them, they have to be, the original taxidermist has to build some kind of a form for it. And the form in really old days, it might have consisted of a wire cage that they plastered and they shaped it to how they particularly wanted that bear to look. And I think modern day, taxidermists can order up
the right kind of form that they would like, and they'd talk to their customers to ask them how they would like to be mounted. But anyhow, one of the big problems, like on his foot, was that it had gotten smashed in, the plaster had cracked, and before I could do anything at all, I had to go in there behind the fur and build the form up. And those were all the little pieces that were ripped and torn off. So I just had to kind of lift them aside and go in there and build the form up. And then on the right-hand side, there's the finished product, almost finished. The way I work is I usually put little pieces of blue tape on things. And, you know, when I find a little thing that needs to be, excuse me, detailed out, I'll put a little blue tape on and come back and do them when I'm in the detail mood, I guess you could say, you know, when I feel like, you know,
you really concentrate.
I can really concentrate and, you know, and get in there and do the little two or three little hairs that it might need to finish it off. So, but it, at any rate, you can see the difference. It's on an ugly stand right now, and then eventually the movie people over at CBS, they went ahead and the studios, they went ahead and had one of their prop guys finish off the stand and make it really nice, and then, you know, before it was actually filmed and so forth. So,
great. Okay, and what we're going to talk about now are some guidelines for handling specimens. And we have a list of different types of specimens, and we're going to go through them one by one. And this is a mount specimen, and this one was not treated by Wild Bills. I got this from the internet, but Mary's going to tell us a little bit about it. Now, Mary, what's the difference between a mount and a full body mount?
You know, I'm not exactly sure what, you know, what, if I could really explain that, I would say this is a mounted head. A full body mount would be the entire animal, like the grizzly bear and then the polar bear that had shown, that was in a previous picture. Those would be what you would call full body mounts. And in fact, you know, like lions, bears, just about any of the animals, you know, could have been treated that way if that's what the owner originally wanted to do. So.
Okay, great. And we'll have some more photos of the mounts and full body mounts. But one thing that I've learned in my experience is that a crucial point for moving taxidermy items and mounts and things is to do as much as you can to recreate the way that the mount was installed. So with this particular one, it's on a base. And so we want to build a crate that's going to stabilize that base. And we want the antlers to be, you know, spread out full inside the crate. So we don't want to lay this specimen on its side or back. We want to do everything that we can to support the antlers as well. And so we may need to attach some foam to the inside of the crate that we're building. And as far as estimating, you know, this is probably going to be one of those open items, and the efforts that we take to build our crate, we're going to build that out as carpenter hours along with the materials. But if you have a wall-mounted mount, then we're going to build our crate to encase the whole item so that we can hang it on a support inside the crate. We might have to have a counterbalance on the bottom of the crate as well. Okay, here's our grizzly again. So this is a full-body mount. Mm-hmm. And moving the full body mounts is trickier. And so an important thing is to keep it on its base. And you can see here that, as Mary said, this is on a base. It's not very attractive, and it's going to be remedied. But we want to move the entire piece so we can build a crate around the entire bear so that he's inside of a wooden crate. Again, maybe providing supports for his arms. And then Mary was explaining that these older full body mounts were originally built on a wire form covered with plaster. And she said that there were even times where there were gaps in the form and the skin was simply stretched over these air gaps or valleys. And there was no direct support in some of those areas. And so then those areas are particularly weak. And as we saw in that previous photograph of the gentleman moving the bear, they actually had their hands on the body of the bear as they were moving it. And so we either want to move it by the base and not allow the bear to wobble up above, or we need to support it inside of a crate. And then Mary's often used the term with me, trophy specimens, and I'm just not from the hunting world. So she explained to me that there are trophy specimens that hunters try to get the biggest and best catch. And so we have an example here of the largest bear on Earth. I'm not sure if this is totally current, but this one is from 1967. And so this gentleman is very proud of his bear, and it's, you know, it's very tall. And you notice here, too, that the base is decorative, so it's been finished off. Some resources that Mary has shared with us is the Safari Club International. Trophy Rooms is actually a publication that people send in their photos of their trophies. And these are compiled into books, and you can purchase those online at Amazon.com. And then I just saw a documentary this week about Texas, how they have a lot of conservation and hunt clubs that actually raise and breed wild animals, and then they charge people to come in and hunt them. And they feel that they are actually helping to preserve the animal breed. And so it's kind of controversial. It was interesting to me. But, you know, just something, I think that we need to be knowledgeable about a lot of different areas so that when we meet the insureds, that we can speak with them, you know, and understand where they're coming from and their passion for their trophies. Okay, so here's that photo again. If you notice, the gentlemen are moving the bear by its hind legs and putting a lot of pressure on the specimen. I apologize for my typo. I just see that. but again, you know, this is something that we want to avoid. The trophy is not protected in any way, shape, or form. And so not a good example. Okay, here's a skin rug with a flat head. So it does not have a form in its head. So this is a rug, and so Mary was saying that we can lay it on a tarp or a sheet, and rolling it is better than folding it. We want to use the tarp as like a gurney to provide the support so that we're not pulling on any of the limbs or paws or anything that's going to cause damage.
Especially if it's wet. That's, I think, it's mostly important if it's wet.
Okay, great. Yeah. Okay. And then we have some skin rugs with full heads.
Yeah. I call these the happy lion couple. They were in a fire, and they got singed, and they were just a horrible, dirty, muddy, ashen mess when we got a hold of them. And little by little by little, we cleaned them and restored them. And they're ready to go home to their mom and dad, you know. And in this particular picture, they were very much a member of the family.
Mm-hmm. And then we had some water damage.
Uh-huh. Should I tell the whole story on this one? Okay. This was a regular customer of ours, and they had a beautiful, beautiful penthouse up on the top of a building on the Wilshire Corridor in Beverly Hills area. And this polar bear was very, very fortunate to live in this marble bathroom. You say he was privileged. Well, he wasn't real privileged when the jacuzzi overflowed on him. So they quickly, you know, since we were fairly local, they quickly brought him over, and we went through the processes of drying him out and getting him back to shape. And here he is back at home again, a real happy camper. And, I think he's probably got a scuba set up standing by in case anything happens again. But this just kind of reminded me of another little pitfall, too, that I didn't think I even mentioned to Barbara in some of our original conversations. You know, sometimes you've got a white rug like this, and maybe you have a lining. Lining might be bright red or something like that. And there's always the problem of having to act pretty quickly so that if the red felt or whatever it is on isn't color fast, that color, when it's wet, isn't going to soak in and discolor the light-colored fur. So that's kind of another little pitfall to kind of look for if you come across anything like this. It's wet.
Is it reversible at all, the dye transfer?
You know, in something white like this, it's very, very, very hard to get out.
Okay.
Very hard. Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you for sharing that. And then Mary was saying, as far as how to wrap this item, we would fold in the front legs behind the head, and then fold in the back legs. And now we have kind of like a rectangular shape.
So it's one side and then the other side.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so the...
Like the left and the right feet to the middle.
Okay.
And then the other side to the middle, and then you have your rectangle from that.
Okay, yeah. So we're going to fold in the left side first, and then we'll fold in the right side. And then starting from the back,
mm-hmm.
we're going to fold it up a third, and then a third again to protect the head.
Right, and hopefully, you know, that last fold will go over the top of the head. And you can really... You know, this might be something that you want to determine the age of the animal, because if the animal's really, really old, you don't want to fold it in any way. You'd be better off rolling it, because you don't want to create any sharp corners that might, become damaged or crack if it's really old and it just doesn't want to be folded.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, again, the best thing would be to contact Mary or another expert and ask for their expert advice on how to handle the piece before anybody makes any attempt to move it. Okay. Mary was telling us about the importance of the age really makes a difference on how we handle things as well.
Right. Like for instance, if an animal skin rug, like perhaps a polar bear, for example, that we just looked at, it's a good idea to determine how old it is, you know, especially if it gets wet, because some of the older skins, if they're really, really old, you could kind of think of, just an example I like to use is, like, think of a graham cracker cookie, you know, so maybe the polar bear is really old, and if you did bend it like a graham cracker cookie, it might crack, okay? But if it gets wet, it could also get kind of crumbly and want to pull apart if it's not treated right. So that's, you know, a very, very important thing is to know how old it is before you start even touching it.
Okay. And then some other signs of age is dried skin, dried leather, brittle fur shafts, missing pieces of the item. And again, we want to ask the insureds if they have those missing pieces, because then a restorer would be able to use those to bring the piece back to restorable condition.
And it's always nicer to restore something with its own original pieces, you know, so that the fur is the right length and density and color.
Okay. So, oh boy, sounds like, you know, that artistic background really helps out a lot. I never thought about the fur going in the right direction.
Yeah,
that's an important feature.
There's a lot of subtleties. As I said earlier, if you have a cat or dog or bird or any kind of critter at home, just take a look at them and see all the intricacies of how the fur works on the body, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to some extent, we have our head of hair and our cowlicks and, you know, things like that going on. But just look at your animal. It's interesting.
Yeah. So it's important having an expert looking at the piece and putting it back together again. And then I noticed on the cheetah that it looked like you added whiskers as well, huh? In one of the original photographs.
Right, yeah, I did, and we use something that just looks just exactly like the real whiskers, you know, so that works out really well. And I just thought of something else just now, and I was kidding Barbara about this the other day. She just called it a cheetah. Okay, so no, that's okay, Barbara. It happens all the time, and that might be another thing that we haven't even talked about, that in the terms of spotted cats, the person that's working with the owner in your world, might want to ask them, you know, I see you have a spotted cat here. What kind of cat is it? Because it's a very, very common mistake. You know, most people don't know the difference between a cheetah or a leopard or a jaguar. And there's subtle differences that you really have to kind of be in that world to know the difference. So that might be something that you might want to be sure. And whatever it is, a bear, you know, is it a Kodiak bear? Is it a grizzly bear? You might want to ask the owner, so that when you actually write out your forms and so forth, mm-hmm. that you have the correct information on there. I mean, even one time I picked up an animal from a customer, and her housekeeper had it all kind of bundled up, and I wrote down that I was picking up a leopard without opening it up and looking at it. And so a couple months later, when I returned a jaguar to my customer, she went, well, you said you took a leopard. Now you're bringing me back a jaguar.
Oh.
So that was one of those little loosey-goos mm-hmm. on my part. We certainly got it all figured out. And she had a couple dozen animals. That's why, you know, it became an issue.
And that's a good point. For those of you that have gone through my digital photo inventory training, that's one of the easy mistakes that we all can make, because you know, we have limited information on all these different varieties of items that we're packing out. And so I like the photos to tell the story. And as Mary said, ask the homeowner for the correct information. Okay, deodorization is an issue for us if we're doing fire restoration. We know smoke odor affects so many different things, and furs are porous. And I didn't realize that with these pieces that if they have a head mount, that the head cavity can actually trap the odor. And so they actually have a form that the head is stretched over, and it could be made up of foam or paper mache or plastic, and all these materials are going to absorb the smoke odor. And so, Mary, could you tell us some methods maybe of deodorizing?
Well, you know, I can usually take care of all the stuff on the surface. You know, I can soak, you know, I have special chemicals and so forth that we've developed over the years that I can pretty much take care of the leather part, the fur, and what I call the back of the fur. Again, I call it the leather side. That can be deodorized and pretty much neutralized. But, you know, if you get inside the paws or inside of the head, then that becomes a little bit more of an issue. And we were discussing ozone machines, you know, and I have often used that situation when nothing else has worked for me, and that seems to do a pretty good job. As I mentioned to Barbara, my ex-husband was a fireman, you know, and he would come home from a fire, and he'd just scrub from head to toe and brushes and under his nails, and his fingernails would just smell for a week, you know, from that fire, and it just gets into everything, mm-hmm. doesn't it? You know, I mean, yeah. That's not my world so much as it is perhaps all of yours, but, I mean, that was just my little experience with it, and I know it's a tough thing to get out of there, mm-hmm. and so I've just kind of used the ozone situation as a last resort, but being in the industry, you know, it's a little bit controversial, I believe.
We just have to be careful with certain furs. Some fur shafts are hollow, as Mary can attest to, like elk and antelope, and so we just don't want to just randomly expose trophies and furs to the ozone room. We may want to consider other types of deodorization, like the vapor tech technology or hydroxyls. We don't want to set a blanket rule. Mm-hmm. Mary's had success with ozone. Unlimited pieces. And ozone can accelerate the aging process, and it can also make certain furs brittle. So we kind of use that as a last resort and, you know, allow the experts to determine, you know, what would be best based on the type of fur and the specimen. Okay, so here we go with our antelope and elk fur information. And as far as collecting data, we as, you know, the restoration professional, we need to make sure that we've got documentation, open communication, because that's what's going to protect us the most. So some of the information that we want to get from the owner of the pieces is for each individual piece, we need to know the age. And then Mary likes to engage them into a story about the item so we can help understand the sentimental value of it. We can also ask about the origin of the piece, if they have an appraisal on the piece. Is there additional insurance coverage for it? Some of the specimens actually have names.
Okay, yeah, I was just sitting here giggling because, over the years I've had some regular customers, and they've named some of their critters, and some of the names have been Fluffy and Wolfy, and there was Little Herman. Little Herman was a little leopard, and the customer would call up and say, I want to bring Herman in because he needs the tips of his ears fixed. They're a little bit they got bumped or something like that. He needs to have his ears fixed and a cleaning. And I would, it was just kind of a fun, you can't do this with everybody, but sometimes if you find somebody that's a little bit more on the fun side, you mm-hmm. can, and they've named their animals, you can kind of bring that into it. Yeah. And it keeps it in a little more of a fun, warmer environment when you can do that. So
we want to have that personal connection with our insured, so, in all due respect, if they call their animals names, then we might go along with it, huh? Okay, and then we want to ask, are there additional pieces or parts? We need to document the pre-existing damage. We need to ask if there was any pre-existing damage prior to the peril, before the fire, before the water damage, any weak points that the items had. And then we need to kind of look ourselves. Sometimes the insureds don't even realize it, that there may be pet urine damage. They've got a pet dog or cat that found a favorite spot on the rug or the animal mount. And so the uric acid is going to react with the leather in the tanning process, and that's really pre-existing damage. And, we need to know that. And so it causes rotting and curling. We want to check for insect damage, maybe holes in the lining, moth damage. Mary was telling me about a particular coyote fur rug that had long hair, and where the fur meets the leather, the moths were chewing their way across, and puffs of fur were literally falling off. And then she said that beetles can eat away the fur and leather, and then obviously rodent damage if critters kind of make a home in one of these pieces.
Especially if it's in a basement or attic or somewhere like that where it's kind of just been tucked away for storage and, you know, the people have actually forgotten about it for, you know, a couple years or so. Those would be probably the most susceptible to the rodent situation.
Okay, great. So Mary mentioned things that are in long-term storage. So we just want to stop, slow it down, and take a look for ourselves. Check out the structural integrity of the item before you move it. And then if you were to contact an expert like Mary, she's going to need to know a lot of these pieces of information. You might want to create a form where you can write these things down on each piece. And then internally, as a CYA function, we want to ask if there's been an appraisal done. We want to take our complete inventory of the pieces, take lots of photographs, do our digital photo inventory. We want photos of the current condition, good, bad, or ugly. Document where it's located, take photos of it, the way that it's been stored or displayed, and ask, has it been moved during the peril? Did the firemen move it? Did family members move it? And then as far as contacting a fur expert, we want to, you know, understand the range of services. Do they do repairs? Are they able to replace missing pieces? And then Mary and some other fur experts, this does not include leather repair. That you may be a leather jacket or leather in general. They don't work with fish and fowl, and they leave those to those specific experts. Okay, we have a few more minutes, and we'd like to talk a little bit about the trends. Mary mentioned trends, you know, about how zebras were popular. So in Hollywood, we know about the Cowardly Lion from The Wizard of Oz, and Mary had the privilege of working on the slippers, the feet of the lion at their facility. And then, whose bed is this?
Okay, this was actually before my time, but I just thought it was just so interesting. This particular bed belonged to, this was in Liberace's home, you know, and, you know, his eccentric taste that he had. He has this beautiful French-inspired bed, and then he commissioned a coyote, you know, the wild American West, spread for the bed. And I mean, it was just kind of, I just kind of giggle when I see this picture because, you know, it's just such a contrast. But then that's what he was. He was a character. So yeah, but he was one of the Wild Bill's customers for many, many years. I think he lived not too far from somewhere around Hollywood, and he actually would tell the story of how he came to the front door one day all dressed up in painter's clothes with paint all over him and everything, and he had no idea who he was, you know, to start with, you know, and there's just all kinds of stories like that, but anyhow, just we're running out of time, so.
It sounds like he was a real guy underneath it all, huh?
Yeah.
Underneath all the bling. Okay, and then we're going to come across trophies and mounts at places like Cabela's and the Bass stores, where they have these magnificent displays of the animals. And it's almost like a museum going into a store. But I learned recently that private owners of the mounts lease them to the stores, and then the stores are required to maintain them and keep them clean. So keep that in mind if you ever, you know, have a store like this that has a disaster. that the stores may already have their own resources to help you out and provide restoration services. Now, many restaurants have mounts on display. Tim and I were at a restaurant down in, I believe it's Jacksonville, Florida, and they just had hundreds of mounts all throughout the restaurant, and it was just like a zoo. So beautiful mounts everywhere. And then we have some celebrities that Mary's going to share with us.
Okay. I think these were published, so it's okay. This one's Brad Pitt's part of his compound, and we actually made this beautiful mink bedspread for his bed. Or it's more of a throw; it just kind of covers the top of it. And so he's been a wonderful customer of ours for years and years. However, when it was published as a faux mink.
Oh, no.
I was so disappointed because I really wanted the publicity, you know, to be able to make that a claim, you know, to fame and credit somewhere. But anyhow, in the same place, this is a white fur rug. It's made out of lambskin.
Oh, that was my fault. I mislabeled it.
Oh! Oh, whoops.
I called it mink. Sorry about that.
That's okay. I'm glad I'm here. Yeah, but that is a mink pillow that actually matched the bedspread.
Okay, good. And then they also had a celebrity vehicle that they wanted the fur carpeting in their Rolls Royce. And so this is Himalayan tar, uh-huh. Right?
It's like a goat.
Okay. Yeah. So just kind of wild taste. Then, of course, we have Kate Hudson's bedroom rug, and this is what type of skin?
This one's alpaca. It's my natural colored ivory alpaca rug, and it was kind of cool because she got this one, and then her mom, Goldie Hawn, well, she wanted one too, but she didn't want the same kind as her daughter, so they came to us, and we constructed a white goat rug for her. So that's fun. That's part of the fun part.
Yeah.
Never great. Got to meet them. They always went through their designers, you know, or their people.
Mm-hmm. So, well, Mary, that's such interesting information. Some fun stuff and, you know, some really solid information as to help us determine when to call in an expert. We certainly don't want to make any mistakes with people's treasured furs. So we have a few minutes. If any of you have any questions, you can write them in. We have been recording the session, and we're going to have this on YouTube. And, you know, so if any of your members from your company have wanted to be involved but they missed it, we will be posting it on the internet in a few days. And you can certainly use it. You can link to your website if you'd like and show Mary as one of the experts on your team. And she would just love that. She'd love working with all of you. And so please reach out to Mary. Her website is www.wildbills-furs.com. It's Mary Williamson. She's the owner of Wild Bills Trophy Hospital. And Mary, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a lot of fun and very informative.
Well, thank you so much. It's just, I just had a ball sharing what I do with everyone. And, I mean, I really love what I do. It's very gratifying. It just makes me so happy when I can restore something for somebody, especially when it has a sentimental value. It just that's what juices me. And I really, really, really enjoyed sharing it with you. Thank you.
Well, it's great to see your passion, and of course, we love the passion that you have for restoration. So it's great to know that you're an expert that we can keep in our million-dollar Rolodex, and that we can contact you, and we can contact you just with questions and photographs, and you can kind of help us along.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, great. Well, thanks so much, Mary, and I'd like to thank all of our guests today for listening in, and keep watching for us. We're going to have more and more free webinars with additional experts in the future. So thanks again, and please visit our website. We have a newly designed website. We're really proud of it now. And it's totalcontents.com. And if you have any questions, as you're on jobs and, you know, packouts and things, please drop me a line, email me, text me, and I'd be happy to point you in the right direction to experts that you might be in need of. Okay, thanks everyone. Have a great day. Goodbye.